call this meeting of the Somerset Berkley Regional School Committee on order. A meeting jointly with the Somerset School Committee at 6 p.m. Do notice having been posted. Roll call, Ms. White?
Here.
Mr. Kelly?
Here.
Mr. Machado?
Here.
Mr. Patrick?
Here.
Mrs. Gagliardi?
Here.
And Mrs. Souza?
Here.
I would like to call the Somerset School Committee meeting to order. Do notice it's posted at 6 p.m. Those in attendance, the chair, Mr. Souza, the vice chair, Mrs. Guerrero, Mr. Camara, and Mr. Machado are all here. Mr. Ravello, due to a prior engagement, could not be here.
And we'd also note that with us this evening is the superintendent of schools, Richard Medeiros, director of business and finance, Mark Furtado, director of curriculum, Dr. Brad Smith, director of special education, Mrs. Susan Doe, regional treasurer, Catherine Antonellis, and recording secretary for both committees this evening, Rochelle DeVaris. Ask everyone to stand for pledge allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
First item on the agenda for our joint meeting is the food service program. Mr. Furtado, anything further to information to provide?
Just in addition to what we spoke about last time, we had a meeting with the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education Nutritional Program on Monday, where we again reviewed the state's audit findings, provided the state with an overview of our actions and intents, got support from the state in that regard, had delivered to us documentation to reflect the new regulations and guidelines that went into effect as of September. Again, would not be current guidelines and regulations, never mind the new ones. So we promised the state we would keep that appraised of the committee's decisions and have a meeting scheduled for next week.
Are there any questions from members of the committee?
Either Mr. Medeiros or Mr. Furtado, kind of, since we do have a lot of the employees here from our food service program, just kind of to, you know, walk us through once again, you know, what the intention of this RFP would be for.
Yeah, and I can begin. I'll turn it over to Mark to handle the task. But I mean, all along, as we stated last time, this was a management portion of it. We were not looking at the existing employees. There are 28, I believe, current employees. That their status would remain intact. They would remain school department employees, same benefits. We've incorporated language into the RFP. I'll have Mark speak to that specifically for the board's consideration. We're only talking about a presentation to explore the option on a management basis for the coming year. There's a time sensitivity to the obviously getting ready to do this for the start of school, and that's why we're presenting it tonight. Presented last time. Mark, can you speak maybe a little bit more to the detail in relation? But that kind of captures that piece. In fact, I had a lengthy conversation with ASME representative Mr. Scott Tavera today to assure him of that. He understood those circumstances, and I shared that. I know there's been some media attention given in relation to that. I think that created some misleading information as it relates to or miscommunication. That wasn't certainly our intent. Mark, maybe you can speak to the specifics. That kind of
sure.
Captured the most of it, I think, there.
Yeah. I think I can explain that the committee has expressed on numerous occasions, as you know, I stated in the last meeting, this is not in any way, shape, or form a criticism of our employees. Our employees are working very hard. They're very dedicated. As I explained, I went to every kitchen. I saw dedicated people doing everything they possibly could to serve the students as our son. This is a tie to profound financial concerns, regulatory concerns, nutritional concerns that are far outside the control of the folks who are working on the line in the schools. out of compliance on numerous fronts. Again, this does not pertain to the folks who are serving the students lunch every day in the schools. So the RFP has always intended to be and has been structured to accommodate our existing labor contract and workforce, keeping it intact as it exists today. If they do not become employees of the food service management company, they remain employees of the town and of the region. The food service management company simply comes in and runs the program from a regulatory, nutritional, business perspective.
Yes, Mr. Patrick.
Now, I'm a little confused as far as the employees keeping them intact. You say, is that just for the extent of the contract? Or we'll pass the contract?
It would be for the extent of the current labor contract that they work under.
And then after that?
That would be, again, up to the discretion of the school. That's not something the food service company controls.
So, could you explain how, what's the impact on vacation, those kind of things? That
sure. The benefits, if you will, of the labor contract remain intact as they exist today. There's no change. They are our employees as they are today. The labor contract is enforced. We abide by the provisions of that contract as we do.
So they work for the district?
Yes.
And
the region.
Right. And they work under this
private company.
Right. We're just, you know, supposing that we go in this direction. They'd be working for two? Who would they answer to under this?
The food service director who is on site and is an employee of the management company who is representing the school district and the region food service.
That's who they would answer to or work?
Yes. With all the provisions in terms of worker rights and benefits that are in there.
Even though the contract is with the two school districts?
Yes. The food service management company essentially represents the school plan.
Okay. I did just have a couple more questions.
Sure.
With the prices that were mentioned in the RFP.
Yes.
That's the state mandated that's in the line with the...
With the requirements for reimbursement, yes. That has nothing to do with any benefit to the school district and management by anybody else. That's a requirement of the state now.
Okay. And as far as being eligible for those reimbursements, including reduced lunches, those, do we still qualify for that?
Reimbursement, there are multiple facets to that. Part of reimbursement, obviously, is how you count lunches to get reimbursed for a lunch. On a theoretical basis, a bag of potato chips and a Gatorade is not a lunch. What the state of Massachusetts found is those are being categorized as lunch in some cases in the district. So what that does is raise questions on how we legitimately make claims for lunch reimbursement. We have addressed that with the state, and there are financial thresholds to their penalties that we are hoping still hasn't been calculated out yet. We don't meet. If we don't hit the threshold, there will be no formal financial penalty. If we do hit the threshold, they will request a refund of federal reimbursement for lunch because we did not provide lunches. So that process, the state is still doing those calculations to figure out where we stand.
And under this proposal, they would be, this company would be reporting back to the districts who in turn would then?
This company would do all of the, most of the reporting required by the state of Massachusetts. So the districts would be getting reimbursed based on those reports. There are certain things that the food service management company cannot do on behalf of a school district that we can still be required to do. But that's a probably, you know, I don't know, 10%, 50% of the reporting requirements to state that.
When you bring in a company like this, they guarantee that the staff that's in place right now, who remain in place, that's how I understood this RFP.
That would be a contractual requirement they have, yes.
They can't relocate the staff? Are they restricted, or do they have that?
I don't think we're restricted, and I don't think they would be restricted.
But they couldn't come in and just relocate workers if they so choose to do that, or could they? Do they have that right, that authority?
We do, and I would assume they would. It would be obviously driven by the volume of meals at a given school. If for some reason, the middle school, for instance, found the new program terribly appealing, and all of a sudden started selling lunches far above and beyond what their normal course of business was, and the staff there couldn't accommodate that. And conversely, you know, this is all hypothetical, the North Elementary School students weren't so thrilled with what was going on, and the lunches went down considerably, and they had excess capacity. Then, as would be the case if we were doing it, we'd say, boy, you know, we need somebody there.
But what about out of district, in another town? They say,
No. Our employees,
okay.
Not food service management company employees. They work in Somerset for Somerset, and they work in the high school for the region. They do not go to Swansea or Fairhaven or whatever.
Could I add to that question? Okay, so they can't relocate, but can they eliminate positions?
No.
So if they say, oh, we have 5 workers now selling milk, we only need 3, they
have to make their cost proposal based on our current staff and wages and benefits. And they have to develop their business model on our current employee status.
And we, this is my last question. We just voted and approved contracts with vendors?
Yes.
What happens to that?
Those contracts are at the discretion of the school committee. That's all contracts.
So
what is that? That means if you choose not to exercise the contract, you have that right.
In other words, we've contracted for a specific price, but we don't have to purchase anything at that price?
You don't have to exercise the contract. You can make a decision to do something else.
Without penalty?
Without penalty.
Mark, who would be handling the funds? Who would be handling the money coming in and going out? Would it be the outside vendor, or would it still be the district in the region?
Well, again, that's what I mean by that. Our employees would be handling the funds at the schools if they currently do not have that would change. That those funds would then get sent to, I'm assuming here, where the food service director's office is, to be reconciled, to basically check against what the schools are reporting. Then that would be sent to the town of Somerset to be deposited in the school lunch account for the Somerset J2A program, and to the treasurer for the region to be deposited into the regional school lunch program, revolving accounts. So it would be the exact same process as occurs now, except there would be a series of financial checks and balances that do not exist right now.
So the paid checks will come from the region and the district?
Yes. There are employees who pay them. And the funds would be drawn from the same revolving accounts that they're drawn from.
The few systems that I know that have gone outside vendors have not kept the employees. Is this something new that we're trying to do, or are you, or the districts have done this?
No, in the case of companies I have a familiarity with, they're roughly 50-50 in terms of their food food service management company employees or municipal employees that they're working with. There's no right or wrong answer, good or bad answer. It depends on the circumstance of a given community and a given program.
And the outside vendor will be doing the evaluating of the employee. So if they don't think an employee is meeting their standards, what happens?
Well, no, again, I'm not sure I've ever seen an evaluation of a food service worker here, but we have what we call cafeteria managers. One at the high school level, one at the middle school level, one at the elementary school level, who would be tasked with the right evaluations of their employees. So the food service director will then evaluate the cafeteria managers.
I wanted to follow up on that. That currently, the evaluation, you said you don't know if it takes place right now.
That was, yeah.
But in, let me back up.
Sure.
In looking at these two reports and the RFP, there were a number of different reasons for us to explore different options to bring us
up
to. Yeah, there's a broad spectrum of them. And one of the conversations that we had at the last meeting was possibly that we had a consultant to do this, but this idea of bringing an outside vendor was also an option that would actually bring us ready to be in a better position in September, correct?
The program, the vendors that would submit proposals would have in place comprehensive programs across all facets of food service operations. They would have inventory control, sanitation, financial management, nutrition, menu development, recipe development. I think I could go on.
If I could also add, at the session that I attended with the ESC, we referenced the consultant asked option. Considering the complexity and the detail, although they were certainly not promoting one or another, because they obviously have seen success in both either school department running a lunch program or a vendor run, considering the two audits, though, that we had and what was expected moving forward, they thought it would be extremely challenging have someone on a consultant basis accomplish what we were trying to accomplish in the time frame we needed to. So that question was raised by both Mark and I with the DESE representative who came down from food service.
And I know we discussed it briefly in the last.
And again, I think it's important for the committee to understand when I was in Westport, it was self-op and it was running extremely well. There were some problems. We had to get a POS system, et cetera. That operation returned money. They were very successful. It was, and probably still is. A very successful self-operated. I know how that works. I can do it. It's not impossible. In Attleboro, at a food service management company that was not performing well. And we're in a different one. The one that was not performing well had been there for 30 years. It was quite a shock for the community and for the school committee to have to even consider making that change. And the change was profoundly successful. I don't have a bias in terms of in-house or outsource. I have a profound bias on being effective in serving kids nutritional meals. Again, this is not a knock on employees because they are working their tails off. That's all I can say.
And this move, what we're considering here, this RFP, is an option to look and evaluate and explore what outside vendors might be available to us.
Right, as they said okay, last time, they would come in, they would make proposals, they would give presentations, they would explain exactly what the program is. If that doesn't appeal to the committee, that's the end of the process.
So, I have a question. Just a minute. Just a question. It seems like this vendor would be in charge of nutrition, inventory, and all of that. Why would we still need a food director? Because I'm assuming now that that's the role of a food director. Who's responsible to see if everyone is certified?
I have not reviewed the job description of the food service director, so I can't answer that question.
Because I'm just thinking, if I'm looking at what you're, if I'm hearing what you're saying is that we have someone who is responsible And all I'm thinking right now, the person who's currently responsible for everything that this vendor's gonna come in to do is this, of the, is the food director's responsibility. Why would we keep a position like that? What would that, is that role going to be eliminated?
I think there's a significant value. The workforce as it exists today, it is a requirement of the business model for the vendor. So there would be no change to the workforce. I think for the vendor, there's enormous value. I think we have a very experienced staff, and I think that they can provide, you know, this incredible value through institutional knowledge. They work under difficult circumstances in some cases. I discussed last night about equipment. I think there's a transition period, and it's not months, it's years, where there's enormous value to having the staff intact as it is, and helping the food service vendor manage the idiosyncratic aspects of working in a given community.
I'm just trying to figure that how this, if we're bringing in a vendor to do the responsibility of managing, it seems like we have, each cafeteria has a management, someone who's in charge of the cafeteria at each school.
Right.
Those people answer to a manager, so are we going to have, are we adding another level of management?
Yes.
So there, to me, I find that as an unnecessary waste.
All you have to do is look at the output.
Could I just suggest that I think that that would be an issue that we could address with people that made a proposal, and can, because by offering this request for proposals, we're not obligating ourselves to accept one. And those are the issues that we would discuss with them to see exactly what they, it's quite possible that they have a regional manager who wouldn't be on site, and that they would rely upon the existing on-site management.
Well, I'm going to be very honest with you. Currently, our management has allowed personnel to be uncertified. I'm very concerned about that. We're in a situation where we have no one currently certified in a into run a kitchen, and to bring in a, and it's somewhat all this that's happened in the past 5 years, I'm trying to figure out how did we get to this point. Everyone is just saying let's throw this RFP, but we have issues in how we got to this point, and no one has yet explained to me how we got to this point. What happened 5 years ago in the audit that is still on this current order? Because I did not see the order from 5 years ago. Are there any items that have still remained from one? Because right now we're all talking about, oh, we're going to agree to it, but there's a problem here. And if the problem lies, let's go back to the corporate world. There's always someone in charge. Something has failed. I understand there's new requirements by the state. Those I can accept. But how you know, a simple certification, I have a hard time believing that this didn't get popped. Is this something new that just happened? FY13 coming up?
Let me address that. I think that you've got two things going on. One is that I think if you look at the audit from 5 years ago, you see very similar outcomes. I also believe that the steps taken by the district are well documented from 5 years ago. I think if you would ask anybody in the business, they would be, it would be very easy to tell you that probably the last decade, school lunch as a process and as an industry has changed as dramatically as anything dealing with schools, including technology. It's been a radical transformation of the program. It went from sort of augmenting budgets to providing nutrition to students, and that kind of transformation has been profound. It's a profession. You can get a degree in this now. The forces that school districts are faced with in terms of the ramping up of requirements, and it's not just this year, this has been going on annually for about 5 years, from a nutritional perspective, from a financial perspective, the ramping up of requirements. requirements and expectations and regulations has, you know, I don't think that this is a condition that's unique to Somerset. As I explained to the committee last time, this current audit by the state of Massachusetts is a regular event, but it was much more profound than the audit that took place 5 years ago. The audit I went through now, or before leaving, was much more profound than the audit I went through in Westbrook. The state is ramping up, the whole thing is ramping up. The gap is increasing if you don't take significant proactive steps to address the movement in the business.
Okay, my last question. You had mentioned about technology, that technology has evolved and so has the food service, but I also have, what we do is we're doing the technology piece in the house. I'm just wondering, why did we not, it seems like we have one option. Today, are we going to support this? This is the option, either we're gonna send an RFP and look at all these vendors coming in, but
I think the superintendent addressed it very accurately. We have never come to the committee and said, this is my option. We said, you can do it in-house or you can go out. If you go out, I assure you, it's a multi-year process. This is not something that gets fixed in 6 months. This is not something that if you fire somebody, everything gets better. This is a profound amount of work that would have to take place, which means you have a responsibility and a liability over the next 2 years for the gaps.
And
if you don't want to address those, the more comprehensive method would be to bring in a food service management company. I'm not recommending a decision, I'm giving you your options.
An option right now the two boards don't have, we're asking that they consider that option. In addition, there are issues that we will have to address regardless of which direction the board moves. The OS system, the certification, a variety of things that we will address. We had that discussion with DESE. The representative clearly stated that this direction, exploring this direction, is something they would support regardless of the outcome, ultimately what the boards chose, and compliance issues would be much easier to meet in relation to that based on what their knowledge is in relation to nutritional expectations and regulations. So we're not here tonight today, and I've said this, we've been saying this the last few times, to put one option in front of the boards, but to explore this option in addition to what currently exists.
Okay. The one question that I have is, I raised at the last meeting on page 15, paragraph H of the draft request for proposals deals with current employees. And I indicated that at least I personally could not support the current language, which says that all employees will remain employees of the district, but any new employees would be employees of the food service company. From my perspective, we just signed a new collective bargaining agreement and we're obligated to operate under that collective bargaining agreement until June 30th, 2014. So have you have proposed language to replace this language?
As we indicated to the committee in writing, that there would be proposed language to the committee prior to the issuance of the RFP to that effect. We have not actually worked on that.
But that is our intent. It's not a decision tonight.
All right, so, I'm sorry.
That's okay. I just have a question. Well, first of all, I want to disclose that my mother is an employee of the food service program. So, but I did have a question about the training end of things. Obviously, there's some food service certification that I forgot the name, Serve Safe or something like that. That has to be done and updated whatever those updates need to be done, as well as any training on potential new equipment and the POS system. Who's the responsible party on that? Is it, I mean, the district, I'm assuming, the districts, I'm assuming, would be ultimately responsible for that. But what about the day-to-day responsibilities?
Depending on the course that the committee takes, a safe serve certification, we would have to hire a consultant to come in and do that. There are people who do that. We would request of the school committee to consider a policy that would require two workers in every kitchen at a minimum to be certified as such, because because if a B-certified person is absent for whatever reason, they're going to be in the same situation you're in now. And again, at Westport, the whole staff was certified. That's a multi-day process. It's about $100 per employee. So depending on the number of employees who participate in that process. And also, this is not a situation where you're guaranteed a result. These are very difficult tests. I took it myself. I know what it is. It's not easy. It is not easy. It's certainly not anything that anybody should be embarrassed about. If they succeed the first time, it's a very, very difficult certification to achieve. So it may take two or three tries for a given employee to achieve a certification. It's not a simple thing. So if the committee were inclined to keep everything as is, there would be a series of consultants that would come in over the next, like I said, 2 years, dealing with a whole series of issues. And again, it's not necessarily restricted to the line workers. Again, very dedicated people who are still working very hard. Again, there's financial aspects, there's inventory aspects, there's tracking of temperatures, there's, I could list 100 things. But it would be a long process, a very involved process, and hopefully you have a good result.
So we know that a lot of people here who are very interested in this, we can't hear from everyone who is here, but I know that there are some people that indicated that they would like to give some input. So at this point, we will take...
If I understand this correctly, what you're asking us to do tonight is just to send out a proposal for people to come in and tell us what they can do for the management system. And my understanding of it is this is obviously over the last couple of years, it's become very complicated in regards to reporting requirements and what needs to be done. And these are people who can come in who are experts in that field, and they can manage the food services and take care of all those different qualifications and all the different reporting requirements that are needed. Is that fair to say? And the contract that I see is a one-year contract with renewal options. So they would, if you went with the proposal, they would come in, they would manage it for a year. If we didn't like it or it wasn't working out to our benefit, we could not renew it for the next year, correct? And if it was working out very well and the students were happy with it and the employees were happy, it's something we would renew in the future. Is that fair to say is what we're doing?
There's actually a 90-day provision to cancel the contract at any time at the school committee's discretion.
So we wouldn't have to wait a year?
No.
That's the question. Thank you.
All right. So. Yes.
So I was just actually going with the safe surf. I'm Allison from the high school. When we were hired, we were told that only one person in the kitchen had to have that safe surf, and that would be the manager. So why all of a sudden now that you're exploring food service companies that now you want all of us certified?
Yeah, what I said was in Westport, the entire staff could serve. There was sort of enthusiasm for that. I think it's prudent for the school committee to pass a policy, which I don't believe they have currently, that would require two people per kitchen to be certified, only because somebody who has a certification doesn't come in, there's a death in the family, they're on vacation, they get sick, they go. You still need to have a certified food service worker in the kitchen. So if you've only got one in the kitchen, if he or she doesn't go to work that day, you're in trouble. Now, are there kitchens that operate without a certified person in the kitchen? Yes, here every day, in other places every day as well. But it's not supposed to happen.
Right.
And again, from the committee's perspective, my responsibility to the school committee is to make sure they don't have exposure to liabilities like that. God forbid something had happened, the town or the region would have been in a significant legal position. Again, and I'm not, unfortunately, this kind of dialogue comes across as a criticism, and it's not. This is not your fault.
Yeah, right.
Again,
just I wanted to make sure I understood that you understood that we were never offered
right.
to take that.
I understand.
Because in a heartbeat, most of us probably would have.
So
right,
we understand.
Exactly.
So my
we hear that.
So my second question being is, you bring forth this to the school committee, and you're making it sound like this is something, a new idea of yours, when we all know in the past year have been told over and over and over again that you were not entertaining the thought of hiring out for a food service program. What's up with that?
I first of all, I apologize that I haven't been there for you, so.
So you got stuck with that. you got stuck with.
Again, my responsibility is to the school committee. My opinion is, given the circumstances and the gaps that exist, and it's, again, not your fault. I've said that last time, I'll say that this time, I'll say that every day, that the best remedy from their perspective would be to outsource the operation. And there's been a profound sensitivity to making sure that the employees are not affected by that, and that could be a short contraction.
It doesn't feel that way this night. Only because, only because we were told during the time of the contract this was not an option that they were looking at. Why would we be asking you to sign a 3-year contract? Correct, Mr. Medeiros? You said that to us? So, to me, a lot of the things that, me personally, I can't speak for my other fellow employees, I'm having a lot of trouble swallowing and believing.
Yeah.
So you're telling, okay, after the 2 years is up, 2014, we could be on the chopping block, and not that new food service company could bring in all their new people.
No, again, theoretically, you could be on the chopping block
tomorrow.
Regardless, it had nothing to do with the food service management company. Again, it's at the school committee's discretion.
Mm-hmm.
Just again, as a for instance, we expect food service at the high school to run about a $20,000 deficit this year. Can't live that way, so what do you do? You know,
is that true?
I just did the CAC budget for June for the high school, and right now they're in the red about $5,300, and that doesn't include the June reimbursement. That's including the reimbursement for May.
I'm just going to have a wish report for you by the charter, so I can't speak to that. But my point is, I don't think your job security is affected by a food service manager. And there will be contractual provisions to prevent that from being the case.
But as you just stated, the contract can be broken.
No, I don't think that's what he said. And I sat across the table from you folks, and we signed a collective, and that's why I have the position that I have. And I'm only one person, so like, from my perspective, we signed a 3-year contract that's in effect through June 30th of 2014, and my vote will always be that we have to respect that contract, and that when the contract expires, we will sit down at the table and negotiate. And just like in any negotiations, everything's on the table. But from my perspective, at least, until June 30th of 2014, we abide by the contract that we just entered into.
And I echo the same thing as Mr. Pierce. I was the other person that sat across the table from. Without a doubt, and that, you know, and that's been a concern of the entire committee, is the employees. We've repeated it over and over last week in questions to Mr. Furtado over the week. It was about the employees and ensuring that your jobs will be secure. So, you know, I echo the same words as Mr. Pearson. I know Superintendent has some.
I was just going to add, because I certainly sat there as well, my employees, both board chairs and speaking, the commitments to the employees, I mean, I think, and certainly Mark had to speak to that, every conversation that I've had, either individually, collectively, or board, while we're here tonight, was about the employees and keeping that status of those contractual obligations. I will say, though, what has transpired, though, from the time we started negotiations into this time, is a DESE significant audit and findings and a review that took place this winter, that we received findings initially in March and then in April, that really have dictate us accelerating some of our options and exploring other options as it relates. And that's kind of the new player in this whole tier. We had this review, and as a result, that's a factor. But I, you know, the boards have been extremely committed to the employees, and we are as well, and we're going to be sure if, in fact, the RFP moves forward and is supported and explored, that language is reflected there. I just want to speak to that as well.
Okay, ma'am?
I just want to say, when I read the Spectator, I was absolutely floored to know that this has been going on. I don't know when the last audit was or what the results was of the audit, but as we're talking about the proactive, where was the proactive piece of it that nobody picked up? And now all of a sudden, the Somerset School Committee and the Regional School Committee, which is so overwhelmed with now, it's being thrown at them. We have to decide now. Where was everybody in the last 5 years? Where was everybody?
Eliminating jobs.
I cannot believe what goes on in this town. Somerset High School fell apart. Now we're going to build a new school. MCAS is going on. This is going to be another delayed thing. Now we're talking about a new service program that has been falling apart throughout the years, and no one did anything. Who's responsible? Who's responsible for that?
Thank you. Is anyone else? Comments? Yes.
I'm Cheryl Logan, and I am the food service director. And thank you for asking me about what happens to my position. What happens to half of the people here that are only 2.5 hour workers and are not under a contract, including myself? I have been here 22 years, and I am not covered under the food service contract. So how easy would it be for a management company to come in and say, you're gone after 22 years because, oh well, you're not covered under the contract, as well as half of the people here who are not full-time workers and are not covered under this contract? What would happen to them? The full-time is, that's fine. They're all covered, but what about the other people?
I will say again, the people who are currently working for the town of Somerset, for the Somerset Berkley Regional School Committee, are not subject to being relieved of their duties under the auspices of the food service management company. I don't know how.
Because they have signed,
I did not,
an agreement.
The chairman of the school committee said it would endure that way until the labor contract expired.
Okay,
he did not specify that it was unique to the people in the labor contract. This is employees of the town of Somerset and the Somerset Berkley Regional School. It's everybody.
Then those people that aren't covered under the contract should get that in writing. Because
the writing in the contract.
Well, they don't get a contract.
We don't have a contract.
That's what we're trying to make you understand. So
I understand.
People who aren't under the contract, full-time employees are, should get it in writing.
If I could, in the RFP, you would state that all employees from both the Somerset and the region, you know, will be
not the full-time employees.
Will be retained.
That's what exactly it says. It says all current employees remain employees of the district. So it says all. It doesn't say full-time, part-time. It says all. So if they sign this contract, whoever the food management company who signed this contract would then be bound by that.
The exception to that is we have also done an independent work ourselves. And if there is any activity that comes from that audit that would require discipline, that is a function of the food service management company.
It also references hourly rates, fringe benefits, personnel policies will all remain at a minimum.
As they are. They can't change your benefits, they can't change your salary, they can't change your retirement, they can't change your holidays, they can't do anything.
Right. Any other comments?
They're required to submit a proposal that takes you people into account as you are. And then maybe the proposal is acceptable.
Okay.
I don't have a problem with companies coming in and bidding on this, and so we could see, you know, what it is they're going to offer. But I would have a contingency plan, all right? Because I'm skeptical as to if these companies will actually want to come in here and work under, you know, the conditions that we're saying we have to, they have to abide by. So, because look, these companies are here to make money, all right?
Like, the food from the private companies is the same that we serve now. So what's the difference?
Well, I don't think we need to get into a discussion about the menu at this point.
Well, it's part of why they're changing them. They're saying that we're not feeding the kids nutritional food. He stated that lunch is a Gatorade and a bag of chips. Well, the ordinary people only were there for maybe 20 minutes at the high school. Children bring their own lunches and come and get a drink and a bag of chips. Doesn't mean that's the lunch that we were serving them. So that's part of the problem.
It's an issue of whether that was counted as a reimbursable lunch. That's the issue.
And I think that's one of the reasons.
Reimbursable lunch would be what, the reduced and the free lunches? Are those what we're talking about, just in general?
Yeah, the both the state of Massachusetts and the federal government subsidize school lunch programs. It's not just the free reduced, but it's based on demographics of the student body. So you get money for every lunch you serve. And there's a very specific definition of what a lunch is. So if you're not meeting that definition, but are claiming the lunch anyway, yes, that's actually looking for a reimbursement for something you didn't do. And that is what the state found. Again, that's not in any way, shape, or form meant to indicate that you're not doing a good job to the best of your ability under the current conditions.
Kind of it is, because being a cashier, when I get a child that comes through and has a lunch on their table, I charge them for a lunch. If they're only buying a Gatorade and a bag of chips, it's two separate buttons, Gatorade and a bag of chips. It's not a reimbursable lunch.
I understand.
So.
Yeah, that's why it's a terribly complex business.
I've been in food service since I was 14 years old, I know. And the Spectator in its little article didn't help the cause for you people at all. Made us look real bad.
And we don't we don't have duty kitchens, as it was said in the Spectator. Molly Ness, no kitchens. Those kitchens are inaccurate. And that really
we are due to present to the state, I believe, by Saturday, a report on what our option, what we're planning. Is that? No.
Sorry.
Did I read somewhere that we have to submit something to the state on June 30th?
No, we have an extension on that.
That was MCAS. Okay. Thank you. Well, my other question.
I think the response was
we
have an extension.
We
have an extension. They received an extension because we are in the process of possibly looking at an outside vendor.
See, there's where I'm. Here we are. We have an extension because we are possibly looking at an outside vendor.
No, I think it's only till the second.
My question, I'm just piggybacking off of Mr. Patrick. What is option two?
Option two is maintaining an in-house food service operation, as I said, and bringing in a whole series of consulting support to establish processes and procedures that are consistent with the requirements of the state of Massachusetts and the United States Department of Agriculture. That would likely be a two-year process with our fingers crossed.
I'll ask from the regional committee, is there a motion?
Yeah, I'll make a motion that we adopt the business manager's request to send a request for proposals for the operation and management of the Somerset Berkley Regional School Districts as proposed in the RFP, which was sent to us.
With a change in the language regarding the employees?
Yes.
We discuss.
Section 15 to change the language as proposed by Mr. Pierce.
Second.
All right. Motion made by Mr. Kelly and seconded by Mr. Gagliotti. Any further discussion? In the absence of further discussion, roll call vote. Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Fitzpatrick?
Aye.
Ms. White?
Aye.
Ms. D'Souza?
Aye.
Ms. Capagnati?
Aye.
Mr. Machado?
No.
And the chair votes aye.
On the Somerset side, I'm looking for a motion. By the request of the business manager. I will make that motion. I'm now looking for a second.
I'll second.
There's a motion and a second. We're going to do a roll call vote. Mr. Machado?
No.
Ms. Pereira?
No.
Mr. Kamara?
Abstention.
Abstention. And I vote aye. So it is in the negative.
We're back in the region to go forward with proposal just for region.
The highway that I need that I've put service in coming to command for that.
We're all one, one unit, right? Somerset and.
No, it's executive session. Well, I think we need to give some direction to the administration. I think we're gonna, you're gonna have to give us a written outline as to how you intend to address these issues. I mean, we know the implications here mean that we are going to have to undertake a very significant effort to change what has been occurring. We have to focus on the training. We have to focus on the nutritional aspects. We may have to hire a consultant. We may have to hire more than one consultant. So we're going to need an outline as soon as possible. We may have to have another meeting because this is something that we need to try to address before September.
So I would agree.
You know, right off the bat, I would say, let's ask the technology director to look into a POS system.
We've already done that.
Okay.
That was going to be our obligation under the request for proposals anyway, so we're going to have to do that.
I mean, the board needs to know, we need to submit a response to the DESC based on the decision tonight anyway, so as a result, you obviously, all that information that you just asked is going to be expected from the state perspective in relation to beginning the process of compliance.
Yeah, and we need to know the cost as well because this is all on budget. So. I'm also surprised to hear that there might be a deficiency that we're operating in the red this year. I was under the impression that we were at least breaking even. So we need to have a little more information about that.
Yes, that's one question too. If we went forward with the RFP proposal, there would be no cost, correct? Because, and if we don't go, there would be significant cost to the K-3 and the region, which is unbudgeted at this particular point.
Correct.
And the RFP, this vote was just to request proposals, not to actually go ahead with that process.
You're going to have expenses for equipment.
Yeah. Well, regardless.
Right. Either way, whether the new the company comes in, you're going to buy them the equipment.
Yeah.
So.
Well, that's not necessarily true. We would have expected that we would have negotiated an arrangement where the capital costs were borne by the vendor. But we've had a vote at this point, so we have other important business that we have to get to. I'm assuming there's no motion for reconsideration on the Somerset side, so in the absence of that, we have to move on to the next item of business. So, for the regional school committee, the chair will entertain a motion to go into executive session in accordance with Chapter 30A, Section 21, for the purpose of discussing negotiations for compensation for the superintendent of schools and for the purpose of discussing the negotiation update with the Somerset Teachers Association bargaining units because an open meeting would have a detrimental effect on the board's negotiating position. The Somerset Berkley Regional School Committee will hold its regularly scheduled meeting following this executive session.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Machado and seconded by Mrs. Gagliotti. Roll call. Mr. Machado.
Aye.
Mr. Gagliotti.
Aye.
Mr. Souza.
Aye.
Ms. White.
Aye.
Mr. Patrick.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly. Chair votes aye.
Somerset Board would like to go into an executive session requesting in accordance with Chapter 30A, Section 21, for the purpose of discussing negotiation for compensation of superintendent schools and for the purpose of discussing a negotiating update for the SDA bargaining unit, because an open meeting would have a detrimental effect on the board's negotiating position. The Somerset School Committee will not be going back into open session. We will be closing session, so I need two votes, actually. One to close, or one for the executive session. So roll call vote. What motion I need?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Roll call vote. Mr. Kamara?
Aye.
Mr. Kerr?
Aye.
Mr. Machado?
Aye.
Chair votes aye as well. And I will look for a motion to close the open.
So moved.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous. I will return to open session, please. Chair will entertain a motion to accept the superintendent's recommendation that the committee accept the secretary's report of open session minutes of June 14, 2012.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Ms. White, seconded by Mr. Machado. Any discussion? The absence of discussion, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Superintendent recommends the committee accept the secretary's report of executive session minutes of June 14, 2012.
Moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Souza, seconded by Ms. White. Any discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. The next item on the agenda is consider change to Somerset Berkley Regional High School Student Handbook. Dr. Mosley?
I will be brief. I just want to start by saying that the draft that was sent to you is the handbook that was sent over the email was a draft. We draft them just to prepare for the next year. So there are some edits we're finally making. Certainly, when you're doing a handbook, you have to make sure it all lines up. And then when you send it to the copier, they actually do a really nice job making sure they're lined up. So there's only two changes that we are proposing this year. Changes that we've made, and this is the district-wide, the physical restraint of students. We added some more language around that. That was the initiative through the region as well as the K-8, and we've added some additional language that's consistent with Massachusetts law around procedures, definition, different definitions of physical restraint, the training that's required by the state, or reporting out by the state as well. So I highlighted those for you in those two folders. And the second piece that we changed to our handbook is a community service requirement. Beginning with the class of 2014, those are the juniors of this year. They are required to do 20 hours of community service as well as part of the graduation requirement. So one of the things we've done about, just to kind of give you some background, is that we notified those students beginning freshman year. We start that process only because we always get the, I'm going to do it next year, I'm going to do it next year. And then by the time it's 2014, the students wait sometimes for the last minute to get 20 hours in. So we try to be proactive and have them work on community service activities a little bit their freshman year, a little bit their sophomore year, junior year, and we like to see them done by seniors. But please keep in mind that high school students, sometimes procrastination, they tend to think that things can get done very quickly, but at any rate, we put that in our handbook in addition. So those are the only two changes. As I said before, the handbook is always a work in progress. When you're doing a handbook, you just want to make sure things are lined up, things are clear. It is certainly, when I say it's a work in progress, there are things that pop up throughout the school year that we try to put into the handbook that is consistent with state policy as well as the policies here in the district. If there's any questions?
Mr. Patrick.
As far as the community service requirement goes, who's going to keep track of the hours?
The guidance counselors keep track of that. The students' individual guidance counselors will be kept up.
They're aware of that?
Oh, yeah.
And another thing, but the school I work in, we just implemented community service this year. And I think one good idea that they did was instead of 20 hours total, they made it, broke it up by the 4 years, you know, 5 hours freshman year, so on. And that, I think, is helps with the procrastination problem. So it's just something to think about.
Is there direction given to students or examples of activities they can participate in? So if someone comes in there and they have no idea?
They can be big buddies. They can be guides or parent-teacher conferences. There's opportunities where we have like basketball games. They can collect tickets. There are some things that are outside, like they can do like Raiders reaching out. We have that activity as well for students.
So is there kind of an orientation on this particular piece at the start of the school year?
Yes.
So that they know and they know what options they can sign up for and get their hours done.
At the beginning of each year, thank you for bringing that up. At the beginning of each year, we have meetings with each grade. And we go over the handbook. We don't like spend 3 hours going over this handbook, but we don't typically do that. What we do is that we go over the poignant points of the handbook, talk about some of the things that are important. And for the class of 2014, we really take some time and stress to the community services.
And you'll do that with the class of
2016, yeah, so everybody has that.
Dr. Mosley, with the community service, is it, because you reference a lot of community service, but school days, is there a community service that you're getting referrals to do out of school? So if they are doing something like maybe like a Big Friends, Little Friends with family service, or the Smiles program with People Inc., or whatever, maybe like a mentoring program, or even at that church, or, you know, is that included with their community service as well?
There's some flexibility in terms of how students can complete that requirement. It's, like I said before, it's always a work in progress. You can't just stand on the street corner. Like, sometimes we have students, like I was at Stop and Shop the other day, and we had cheerleaders canning. That's not community service. That's part of a separate. That's not, you know, doing something giving back to the community. We had some students from the Raiders reaching out in the Key Club. They did some, they had some jerseys on. They worked with Bank 5, cleaning up the downtown area down there, down the corner. They were doing some of those. So that is a form of community service. We have students that do some fundraising during the Christmas season for needy families. So they do some community service that way as well. So.
Thank you, Dr. Mosley. We've been very fortunate in the kids of our high school. They've done a lot of community service throughout, you know, for many years. I've noticed that, at least in the last 6 years. When you say 20 hours, are you prorating it for the existing classrooms, like existing class, like for instance, the senior class coming in, are they going to be required to do 20 hours, or are you going to prorate them down to 5 hours?
No, it's just for the class of 2014, they have to fulfill that community service.
Okay.
And they were aware of that when they were freshmen. We need to spring on. So they have been hearing the same message since they were freshmen.
Okay.
The only question that I have is one of my real concerns, as you probably know from the presentation they gave, is bullying, the issue of bullying. And when I went to look for this section on bullying, the table of contents says it's a page 105.
Correct.
It's actually a page 108. I think the table of contents got off somehow.
Yes, it does. It gets off. It does that just by printing it, but when we send it off to the printing press, it's still off, but they have to like line it up.
I see, so it's gonna be adjusted. So
yes, it will be adjusted.
That's the point you made earlier while I was looking for the bullying.
I'm
sorry. But the other observation I would make about the bullying section is, from my perspective, it's rather cryptic, and it makes no reference to the fact that we have a comprehensive anti-bullying policy, and it and the other thing that's significant, and I know that very often in the case of discrimination such as sexual harassment, there's a requirement that the persons who can be contacted to address a situation are specifically referred to, And there's nothing in this bullying section that would give students any indication of who they should turn to in the event of bullying. So I would just, I don't know whether it's possible to make any additional changes this year, but I would ask you to look at the section in the handbook, because I think it's a very important issue, and we do have a policy, and I think the policy enumerates who students can contact in the event that they have an issue, and I think that would be important to include in the handbook at some point.
I remember.
And also perhaps to not to include the full policy in the handbook, but just to let students know that there is a full policy that they're able to access in the event that they would like to.
If I could just respond, and sure. The handbook, it just says, in witness to bullying, should also report it to the appropriate school personnel, administration, guidance, adjustment counselor, and or school resource officer. So it does say that on page 109. Let's say that, Mr. Chairman Pierce.
Okay. Good. I would like to see a reference to the policy, the fact that there is a more comprehensive policy that it's available. Is it posted in the high school?
It's posted in their handbook. In other words, all of our students get a copy of this handbook. There's also, we do have our handbook available to our students, so they do know this. We also, part of our presentation, we asked and encouraged not just students to review the handbook about bullying and harassment, we also tell the students to review it as well, for two reasons. They have to know the definition, but they also have to know the consequences and ramifications of bullying and harassment as well. It's taken very seriously at the high school level. In some cases, it results in suspension from school. Some of our students don't know that, so we make it very clear about the difference between bullying and harassment, as well as the consequences when students such behavior. We also, too, do, before we, I kind of went to the punitive pieces, but we also do some follow-up, too. We also do peer mediation. We also do some counselors where NASA talks to some of both the victim and the perpetrator, so to speak. I want to make it very clear, usually when we get into these situations like this, there's usually a story behind the story. So we try to, I know Mr. Kelly, you talked about, like, what do you do? And I said, you have those teachable moments. Remember, we talked a little bit about that. We try to first engage in those teachable moments, that dialogue, that sense of understanding different perspectives. But if you continue, and it is ongoing, there is a punitive piece to school consequences. But also, in some severe situations, we do have the school resource officer involved as well.
Thanks. Any other?
So there's a separate bullying handbook? Is that what you're saying? Oh,
no.
And I thought at one point we had, during the interim regional school committee, set up a hotline. That's no longer in place. Was that the case?
We don't have a hotline.
Okay.
My recollection is the committee specifically voted to establish a hotline. So I'd like you to at least consider that.
Just kind of a place where people can make anonymous.
All right, so we need a motion to approve the changes to the student handbook.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Souza, seconded by Ms. White and Mr. Kelly. Is there any further discussion? In the absence of further discussion, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Unanimous. Thank you. I would like, with the indulgence of the committee, to kind of move around on the agenda a little bit, because we have some issues that we really need to address tonight, and we have a rather lengthy agenda, and we've spent more time than we anticipated in our joint meeting. So I would ask, if there's no objection, to move to item number 3 under old business, year end financial planning. Otto?
Yes, I have no objection, but we did the Region secured the $120,000 for stabilization as of today. We are still tracking to the number I have been on for a couple months now, something between $400,000 and $500,000 to do the final payroll as of today. So I'll have a better number for you early next week. It looks like the personnel services side of the budget is very tight and will come out pretty close. The surplus will be found on the expense side of the budget. Again, we're remaining at the kind of $400,000 to $500,000 range. We did receive two very specific requests from the high school for spending at year end. One is for a copier for St. Adams program. His copier can no longer functions. And the same with the athletic director's office copier can no longer functions. Those two items would cost approximately $18,000 to purchase. And that is actually the only kind of end of the year request that we made on the regional side.
So we're not going to prepay any special ed tuition?
No, out of the surplus that you have at the end of the year, we paid, I believe this board requested a $300,000 expenditure on special education tuition. So I'm indicating you will have that money and it will be used for that. You'll probably have about $100 to $150 left over.
So do we have to do a transfer?
So I would have thought we'd have to vote to put the money into the stabilization fund.
Or just sign the bill.
The bill is here.
Yeah.
Okay. This is on the budget line. There's no transfer required to do the stabilization fund. That was what you budgeted for at the beginning of the year. It's still there, and that's.
That transfer is what we're assigned. Yeah.
There's no transfer. The expenditure as budget.
But what about the copy machines? We have to go.
Copy machines will require transfer.
Well, we can't do it after tonight, okay?
Well, what are you doing? Expenses, though.
Out of expenses.
Copy machines are important.
Well, as I pointed out to you tonight, I knew that I had read somewhere that at the regional level, every transfer of a line item requires approval of the school committee. And the regulation says specifically that that responsibility is non-delegable. So there
is, like, we have not followed that.
Well, why don't we first consider authorizing the purchase of the copiers? Does anyone feel?
I'll make that motion.
Second. Okay. Motion made by Mr. Patrick and seconded by Mr. Machado to authorize the purchase of two copiers at the cost of $18,000. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
No.
Okay. All those opposed?
No, I'm sorry. No.
The chair votes aye, so it's 6-1. Now, I think that we have the FinStat report here. As of, it says it's as of 6:30.
Which would be impossible since we're not there yet, but yes, that is the security date.
Can we use that money to help offset the cost of the cafeteria and some service issues that need to be brought to compliance? Can we enroll the workers in the food safety costs and the serve safe costs and by the POS? Is that something that would be?
Doesn't it have to be certified first unless it's spent at this point?
I believe you can encumber the money to indicate that you will have an intent to spend it. Again, one of the difficulties with the POS question, as I explained last time, is there's a from the board is, it's probably stronger than rumor and less than the fact that the high school would migrate off the MS, that decision would probably impact which city we'd go in. And there's still no kind of clarity on that discussion. But there's not going to be a profound range in cost of the POS system across vendors. It's going to be very close to the same. Comprehensively, the quote is something around $20,000 for both K through 8 and 3 by line. So I think they're about a third of the line, so you could estimate something around $6,000 or $7,000 specific to the region for a POS system.
What other items are concerning you that we would need to be spending on with the money that will be left over from this FY 12 budget?
On the region side?
Yes.
Again, I haven't, not much. You don't want to make any, what we consider capital investment for that building. It's going to be ripped down, especially not transferable capital, such as, fixed food equipment. The hope was to have a management company come in and make some proposals on how to bridge going from here to there. Doesn't make sense to do things like buy cafeteria tables which are in our shape over there, because again, cafeteria is going to be outfitted in the schools and not tables you want to transfer over to the schools. There isn't a lot. You want to make sure that people can do their jobs and have the equipment necessary to do their jobs. And then, as Patrick pointed out, copies are kind of lifeblood in the public school system, so that might just support the vote.
Would I suggest maybe as a procedure, in the fall, ask teachers what they need to do to help them do their job.
Right.
All right? So you have that. It's sort of like a wish list. Right. So then when you get to a situation like this, say, hey, so-and-so could use...
That's typically part of the budgeting process. The committee has to recognize to have a budget for 14 in place by December.
But the thing is, sometimes he says, God, I haven't got that in 10 years, why bother?
Right.
All
right,
so let's have him bother.
A new face helps in that regard.
My thought to you is that as we looked at this initially as a building, as a budget committee, in trying to do some long-term budgeting, that certified surplus or whatever may help to offset some spikes that we can foresee in the next couple of years. So that's, as much as we want to fill in the gaps with things that need to be done, we need to be mindful of that it doesn't all need to be spent, because there will be some future expenses that we might need to adjust for.
Yeah, I would agree. Again, given the kind of constraints that there's expressed tonight regarding budget transfers, that's going to be a challenge. Part of the hope in executing budget transfers was to get a better readout of budget areas. So not having that ability to do that actually would be.
Would it help to just have a synopsis of what it is that you want to do and have the budget committee look at it?
It's not possible doing it in a meeting every week or every 2 weeks, whatever it is. It feels like every week. As with any operation, it's sort of like at home, you can certainly plan for the new refrigerator purchase, and you can have a long-term planning for a new car and redoing the living room. But sometimes you come home up 4 o'clock and has a problem that you have to deal with right then and there. That's going to be a heck of a lot easier to do in September, because the budget is still full and rich, than it will be in May, when we have to technically wait until maybe some, there are no dollars in that particular budget line. It's a very difficult position to be in.
Well, the regulation is what it is. We can review it and make certain that it says what I think it says, but I don't see why it's that difficult to work around it. We meet every other week, and in an emergency situation, we'll address it on an emergency. If you have a catastrophe and you need to address it, we'll meet and address it. I guess what I'm concerned about is that there have been a series of transfers that are reflected on the FinStat report, and I don't know whether anyone has a specific question about any of them, because what I would suggest is that we vote to ratify those transfers before the end of the year.
Can I just go back? I apologize. I used the metro. When I walked in and you were talking about each time we move a funds from one line to another line, it has to, in the region, like for a regionalization, because I'm new to this as well, it has to be voted on, because on the Somerset side, we just do one transfer from, we've in the past given the superintendent and the business manager, you know, free access, listens two line, work within the two professional sides and expense. We haven't really micromanaged the line items. Is this something that we need to do in the region by law? I'm just, is that what I caught when I walked in?
Yes, as I said, and I can stand corrected, but I looked at the regulations that track the statute on regionalization. There is a specific provision that says, as I understand it, any transfer of a line item in a regional school district budget has to be approved by the committee. And then it's followed by the sentence or the phrase, and this authority is non-delegable, which means to me that we can't say at the beginning of the year that the superintendent is authorized to make transfers up to a certain amount. We're required to vote on each one. And I realize that may be different than what applies to the K-8 school district. So I think the way for us to address it at this point is for me to entertain a motion that we ratify the transfers that have occurred as reflected on the FinStat report through report.
I would suggest this is probably generated today.
Do you anticipate that there will be any further, were you anticipating there will be further transfers between now and the end of the year?
Well, I'm assuming the copier authorization allows me to transfer both copiers. The only other transfer I would anticipate by the end of the year, city structure, I was required to zero out budget lines. You weren't allowed to have any of the budget lines. But if we're allowed to have a surplus with negative budget lines, then no. The only other transfer that would need to take place at that point would be to accommodate special education tuition, specifically for the special education tuition line. So you would have to take the overages on the expense lines and bring it down to the tuition line to expand the tuition.
I just had a question regarding the athletic expenses. Looks like there's an adjustment there, $30,000. And that's the, we set aside a number, I think it was $45,000, $50,000 for transportation, which didn't take place. There's only $23,000 left in that budget. So why was there a $30,000 transfer out of there?
And there's a $30,000 transportation overage.
So you took it out of the athletic expense transportation that we anticipated but we didn't use and put it to the transportation of the general?
Correct, yes.
So,
how does that work? Like for instance, like sick day buybacks, if we foresee someone is retiring and we, let's say, the beginning of the year, we believe four or five members are going to, our staff is going to retire, we need to, that, those funds that we place in the budget, it seems like if they don't retire, we ask the community again to put more money into that line item. How does that work in the region? How does that, as a student of the region budget now, how does it work? Do we have, whatever is left over in the town, we obviously give back to our town. In a region, it's different. What happens to those funds? And can we, like, let's say next year, if we do have money again left over in retirement fund, why ask the communities to continue perpetually putting money for the same person who we feel is going to retire, but yet they don't retire?
Yeah. I believe this committee had pretty intense discussions on what to do with budget balances at the end of the year. I believe the intent was to take the $100,000 or whatever is left over and designate it as free cash, which has some parameters around how to use it, as opposed to stabilization, which would be much more restrictive. I believe that the committee is, in my opinion, particularly sensitive to assessments in communities, as they expressed when they did a mid-year adjustment to the health insurance, where they became aware that the health insurance budget line was on a black and returned $1 million to the community. So I think as the budget progresses, you're going to have visibility to excesses and understatements. You know, you're going to have to make some accommodations to that, but after, you know, again, I think this group is proven that they're going to be very responsible to, you know, the obligation of the communities to the region that have done so budgetarily this year in that first year of operation. I'm not sure we continue. Sort of the long answer is you can address that through free cash if the committee so chose, but at the same time, I don't think this committee is inclined to not yet grow or something they know isn't real.
Can I just get clarification? Did you say that after we prepay special ed tuition, you're anticipating we have $150,000?
$100,000 to $150,000.
That's a number far lower than I thought you had suggested previously.
Well, I think that number has come down because of the fact that, does that account for the retirement?
Yes.
It does account for the retirement.
Yeah.
So that's putting the retirement money back in.
Yeah.
And for
paying the retirement bill, which we should have a number on in the next week. Again, we just finalized the last year payroll, which is what the town account wanted to do prior to coming up with an assessment number.
So that's paying
the retirement bill, but
also for 2013, we're paying, prepaying some of that sped tuition.
Yes.
But we're not prepaying, we don't have, that 150 is all we have left for either free cash or the retirement, which we didn't budget for. Is that correct?
Correct.
When did we go from 150? When did we go from 300 to 150? When was that whole thing?
What do you mean?
I thought we were prepaying $150,000 worth of special ed, and now we're paying $300,000.
It might be. I don't have that in my budget notebook, but.
Yes, one, maybe $100,000. I get this district's over the last maybe some says there it was
$150,000.
Yeah. The end of the year balance is expected to be $400,000.
Yes.
Somerset
is $300,000.
Okay, so it's $150,000. So then, so if you take the 150 off the 400 to 500, the balance is actually larger.
$300,000.
Yeah. Which we had kind of accounted for because of the insurance was not put into the FY13 budget.
Correct.
We have to take care of that.
Correct.
Can I just ask you a question? So the special needs transportation, it looks like you took a lot of adjustments and added about $150,000 to the special needs transportation for this year's budget. And I know I've asked many, many times. When we're doing the planning budget, I got 2013, all the different routes, but I never got this year's. So how did we go up by $150,000? We budgeted $255,000, but now we made all the adjustments and had $150,000. What was the reason for adding $150,000 to the special needs transportation budget?
We had an increase in the number of students who have we've had a number of students from the region who have moved into the district here just recently, the past quarter. So I don't have figures in front of me right now to be able to tell you exactly offhand, but
The question is, that was the reason why we had to increase the budget in 2013.
Right.
And we've got to break down everything in anticipating 2013, but I probably asked 15 times for the breakdown for 2012. And I've just never gotten that. Now I see a huge adjustment of $150,000. So I just wondering what happened. We budgeted $255,000 and now it's up to $404,000. And that's almost a double of the, well, probably a 40% increase. So just wondering what happened with how we increased it by 40%.
We had discussed that when we sat down as a subcommittee.
Correct, but I never got the, I got the reason why we increased it to 2013.
Yes.
But I never got the information why we're increasing 2012. So is it just a more special needs students?
Students, yeah.
And do we need more transportation? They couldn't fit on the transportation we're currently having now.
We added the answer to the
could you give me the same breakdown I had for 2013, but I have that for 2012?
Sure.
Thank you.
So then you're anticipating we'll have approximately a $300,000.
Yes, yeah, the prepay is going to be the total balance at the end of the year is between 4 and 5. And that's after paying just for time to time. We have a working number right now, we're not $211,000, but that's not final because we didn't do the final payment. That's all for that.
All right, so going back to this, I would suggest that we have a motion to ratify the transfers that are reflected on the FinStat report. It's dated June 30th, 2012.
Should we also include in there an additional transfer to prepay special ed?
I was going to deal with one
separate
issue with it. So moved.
Second.
Right, motion made by Mr. Machado and seconded by Ms. White. Is there any further discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Aye. No.
The chair votes aye, so the vote is 6-1. I believe that we've already approved the prepayment of special ed tuition. So we don't need to consider that. Is there any other authorization? We've talked about the copiers. Is there any other authorization you feel we can address tonight?
Just when was the vote taken for the prepay?
We've got the formulation of that by 13 budget.
But wouldn't we have to vote on it since it's a transfer and it's out of this budget?
Well, I thought within the last month or so, it might have been just before you joined our committee, that we authorized the prepayment of special ed tuition in a separate vote, but I may be incorrect.
Because I know we did it, we had to vote in Somerset, so I just don't want to, if we did not vote for it, or before my time, I'm just wondering, it would be almost wise to take the vote.
Mr. Chairman, I mean, just so it's clear, I say we just make, I'll make that motion to just prepay, just in case, of $150,000 spent.
In the absence of a previous vote, we're authorized to pay $150,000 for
a request up to
our own
number.
Yeah,
legally allowed.
Up to $150,000 to prepay special education tuition. Motion made by Mr. Souza. Is there a second?
Okay.
Mr. Machado seconds the motion. Any further discussion?
I just have a discussion. If we're going to authorize a adjustment, do we have to authorize an adjustment out of a specific fund or line item, or do we just authorize a general adjustment out of anywhere?
Yeah, I would recommend to the city that the funds be derived from the expense accounts. As spec tuition is an expense, and we should be coming from personal services.
And are there funds in the special ed expense lines to cover that prepayment?
I wouldn't think so.
the $400,000 comes from putting all these things together, all the surpluses, you know, $400,000. So we're going to transfer $150,000. Do we just transfer out of the excess? Or do they have to transfer each line item on this budget? I don't know. With the regulations or what they.
My thought is if it's at the end of the year, I would say you could take it out of the excess. If it's in the middle of the year, I think you would have to determine what lines you're actually taking it out of.
I don't need to make it more complicated, but is this prepayment a little different in that it's a not necessarily a transfer to the line items in this year's budget, but it's taking the money left over in surplus from FY12 and paying an expense that's expected in FY13?
No. He would pay out of the FY12 budget if it need to be transferred to special education tuition line. Where it would come from would be surpluses in other lines. As I said, we don't anticipate there being significant surpluses in the salary lines, despite the things like that. Because again, we just process the lump sum at the end of the year.
But we're using a surplus from one year to pay an expense from the next year.
Only because it's specifically permitted.
Right, but that's what I'm saying. So that's why I thought it was a little different, where it's not really a transfer within that year's budget. It goes from one year to the other. But I might be wrong.
I suggest that the motion authorize the transfer of the $150,000 from excess line items on the expense side of the budget.
I will make that motion.
Second.
All those, any further discussion? In the absence of further discussion, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? No. Unanimous. And there's nothing else that you, no other opposition?
Maybe in the future, if we can't delegate to the administration looking at line item adjustments, maybe we could delegate to the chairman of our committee to look at those if there's some sort of emergency or something needs to be done. And that's, I mean, maybe we can do that in the future.
We'll look at that and take it up in the future meeting. I'd like to go to item number 9, which is the report on restraint training. Dr. Smith is here. Do you want to introduce that, Mr.
Yeah,
Pierce?
I can start then, Mr. Pierce. I provided a packet.
Actually, I should preface this. Some people may recall, but others who weren't on the committee, that there was an issue early in the year regarding compliance with restraint training based on a complaint that was filed involving the Wilbur School. And at some point within the last month or two, I received a letter from an individual raising questions about the restraint training at the high school. So I asked that this item be placed on the agenda so that we could get a report on how the district has addressed the letter and the process that was suggested by the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education, and be able to address a response to the individual who wrote to me about restraint training.
Mr. Pierce, I provided for each of the board members and CC'd both Dr. Smith and Susan Doe an overview, a paragraph kind of outlining in response to the question as it relates to physical restraint of student policy. I provided two documents along with that. One is the regional policy. I think there was a reference to a different number of pages. The regional policy is actually 3 pages. It's enclosed, it's attached, to the document that I provided. In addition, I think Dr. Mosley mentioned is being sure it's part of the handbook, which is also part of the expectation. The other document, which is a comprehensive training document that was provided, a PowerPoint presentation that was provided for all staff, obviously we're focusing on the high school and the region. Simultaneously, Sue Doe, as the Director of Special Education, Dr. Smith as Director of Curriculum, myself, did 3 separate presentations, one at the high school, one for the region, one for the middle school and one for the four elementary schools. And I know we're here to talk about the regional piece, but this packet of information kind of captures in response to several of the issues. One was their training. We've established that certainly that not only was their training, comprehensive training, there was an administrative session before the school for all central office directors and high school administration. I think part of the high school principal wasn't in attendance, actually he just didn't sign the attendance sheet, but was present for that piece. The entire staff received the information during professional development at the start of school. If you recall, we have two half days, actually two full days, but we do professional development before the start of school. And then any new staff members who were not present for that regional high school training during that second day of school were provided several additional training sessions. In addition, the school policy on physical restraint of students was also included in opening day information for principals to distribute, and obviously that pertains to the high school. I certainly have, Dr. Smith can speak to it. I didn't want to, he really is not the chief responsibility for this. I know he handles a lot of the policies, but it was a collective central office process as it relates to not only training, but making sure that people had the policy. So there are several questions about, one, the administration being made aware of the training. I think part of it was the attendance sheet where the individual didn't actually sign but was present for that, that we confirmed the document itself, the physical policy. One of the issues at the time of last year's handbook, which went to the interim, was that it was not included in the handbook. And that's correct. It wasn't included in last year's high school. It was after the fact. As you can see tonight, Dr. Mosley was sure to be sure that moving forward, it's now part of the regional piece. There really was no oversight in relation to the meeting the requirements for 11-12. It's an annual requirement and expectation, and you'll see the comprehensive nature of the policy. The regulations speak to the fact that you cite the regulation, not that you need to contain the policy within the training piece, and I think we've met that. Sue, Brad, anything specifically, Dr. Smith, you'd like to add to that?
Sure, just to expand upon Mr. Medeiros's comments, I think the training presentation effectively address the key components of physical restraint, focusing on regulatory requirements, which are indicated in the presentation. So initially, the annual training really provides an overview of physical restraint regulations for all staff in terms of the nature and scope of restraints. At another level, the district provides intensive training for designated staff to serve as school-wide resources on administering physical restraints. That training is coordinated through my office along with Mrs. Doe, because we partner with the South Coast Educational Collaborative in providing nonviolent prevention intervention training. The designated staff who are trained at the high school will then serve as school-wide resources. Those individuals who are trained in specific procedures and protocols and techniques for restraint training. So we do the initial overview for all staff, but it's important to keep in mind that as you review the PowerPoint presentation, it focuses on a wide range of requirements as it relates to state, federal, annual mandated training. And those are articulated within the PowerPoint.
And I just would like to add that the PowerPoints are both on and both websites.
Right.
So posted, they're able to access them at all times in case the information was too much at one sitting.
The physical restraint policy for both districts is also posted.
I have a question. It says key reporting requirements. When to report? Report only restraints over 5 minutes or in any case of immediate. So typically, if the restraint is not a five, if it's below 5 minutes, we're not reporting on that.
You make a verbal phone call, principal, and notify the parent.
But it's not
but
a written
report. If you record it on intervention, it's restraints over 20 minutes or reported to the department.
So restraints over 5 minutes are recorded. They're recorded.
But below 5 minutes, they're not recorded.
No, but there's a verbal phone call to the, and they're, of course, the principal as the administrator at the elementary level and at the high school level. Prevention, and that's the crisis team, the crisis.
Does it, on the elementary level, is it part of the training to notify the faculty that restraint under 5 minutes should still require a phone call?
Yes, and they have intervention reports that they fill out.
Forms of documents, not included in the policy that are part of the procedure and protocol.
And they are trained on that?
They have provided that information, the administrators are, correct?
The administrators are in charge of that.
Any other questions? All right, thank you. I'd like to go to item number three on the building committee update, which is the approval of construction contract with Bacon Agostini. Contract has been finalized. We sent out a copy to everyone earlier this week. We're anticipating that the contract will be finalized no later than tomorrow in advance of the groundbreaking ceremony, and we're asking tonight that the committee approve the contract for Bacon Agostini Construction Joint Venture in the amount set forth in the agreement, in the terms and conditions set forth in the agreement, and that we authorize the superintendent to sign the agreement on behalf of the regional school district.
So moved.
Motion made by Mr. Patrick and seconded by Mr. Kelly. Is there any further discussion? Absence of further discussion, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Chair votes aye. Thank you for that. Under new business, first item of new business is consider awarding a bid for transportation routes. We have a brief explanation of that matter, please.
Certainly, Mr. Chairman. This is the standard contract for transportation for digits to move the distance in the town for many years. The committee's benefit, the rates reflected are a $10 per day per route increase over this year's rates, $10 per day per route, so $258 was actually $248 this year. The other item to note that's of importance is that this bid was sent out for a single year. There are three contracts awarded for transportation in the town, encompassing both the region and the district. The contracts are segmented by routes. That practice is not looked favorably by state purchasing officials. This contract was sent out for a year. The second of the three contracts actually expires next year, be simultaneous to this one. The third contract would have a one-year renewal at the conclusion of next year, which would necessarily have to be exercised, which would allow both the district and the region to issue a comprehensive transportation contract to be bid on. That would be the intent.
And was there, do I recall, a memo where you indicated that this represented an $80,000 increase?
$18,000. That is not specific to the region, that's both.
So it's 18
overall.
Okay. So our share of that would be about a third? I'm assuming on most routes there are three trips, elementary, middle, and high school?
I think that for this particular contract, or many of them, that would be the most true, but I still couldn't tell you that actually happens.
All right, so So you're recommending that we approve this proposal for 1 year with an eye toward looking at a more comprehensive review of the whole transportation picture
next year.
And
again, for the committee's benefit, we've actually had Mr. Fisher, and he has a template of a proposed contract for his review. This isn't any intent to do anything other than make the contract much more transparent and certainly comprehensive. So we're working with the existing vendor to make sure they understand the threshold going in. There are no surprises.
Question. It says the bid price is based on $3.39 per gallon.
Yes.
When does that, is that over the year, over 3 months? How does that $3.39 per gallon?
That's essentially a baseline. That was the price of fuel that he exercised literally on the day the bids were open. That was his most recent purchase of diesel fuel. So your fuel escalator is based on a baseline, and that's the baseline.
So I guess when do you get to that baseline? Obviously, the price of gas, diesel will go up and down, throughout the year. So is it at the end of the year, they take a whole average and say it was 3.41 or 3.30 or the, per month or 3.72?
36 weeks. So there'll be an assessment to the contract. If it's above 3.39, there'll be a credit to the contract.
These do not include the Berkley routes, correct?
Literally from the Tower of Berkley.
Yeah.
No, they do not.
Yeah. So the plan is that when the Berkley contract is up to, we look at the whole thing and try and get one.
That would be a highly desirable option.
I think the Berkley school committee should also be involved in that so that we could, we might be interested in, having our school district came to wait involved. I didn't know if they would be bid that way.
Sorry. Mm-hmm.
Yes, Mr. Machado.
I also noticed that a representative of New England Transit was present.
Yes.
For the bid. Did they place a bid?
No, New England Transit attends transportation bid openings as a matter of business. They are actually a wholesaler of equipment. They sell buses. So they find out who wins the bids, and then they go knock on the door and say, you need any equipment.
Okay.
That's how they do their business development.
So
they used to be some bus business historically, I believe.
This was the only bid that we received?
That was the only bid received. And made sure the contract didn't suggest that.
So I will entertain a motion to approve the transportation contract for the routes set forth in the proposal for 1 year at the prices set forth in the bid.
So moved.
Second.
By Mr. Souza and seconded by Mr. White. Is there any further discussion? In the absence of further discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Next item is consider reappointing the school physician, Dr. Harvey Reback, for the 2012-2013 school year.
It's my recommendation that the board consider reappointing school physician Dr. Harvey Reback for the 2012-13 school year. Last year, you actually made that appointment in September, which is getting started in the process. It's an annual appointment, in this case, reappointment. The salary for the position has not been adjusted. It remains at 13, just for informational purposes, and not necessarily for the vote, but just for informational purposes, $13,871. Is the actual payment, and that's actually the letter that was sent last year. I'm just referencing that kind of moving forward. So it would be my recommendation that a reappointment be made for the school position for that amount. We did, in fact, if you look at the FinStat, actually spent that money on various activities that the school position is engaged in at the high school in addition to working with the school nurse.
And is Dr. Reback the school physician for just at the high school?
That's correct. this is an individual who has handled the KD.
Are there any other questions about reappointing Dr. Reback? And the chair would entertain a motion to reappoint the school physician, Dr. Harvey Reback, for the 2012-2013 school year in the same terms as last year.
So moved. Second.
Motion made by Ms. White, seconded by Mrs. Gagliani. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? No. Unanimous. Next item is to consider approving the Somerset Berkley Regional School Resource Officer Agreement.
Mr. Pierce, I provided you the document that was submitted by Chief Ferrer, spoke to just today, in relation to this, and it really was an update that was missed last year in the process where the previous agreement still read Somerset Schools. In fact, I haven't corrected Chief Ferrer's document. There's a couple other references to Somerset Schools. I don't know if anyone else saw that piece. He wasn't able to provide, and I have this sent to me through the police department. They generate the form, so I wasn't able to make those modifications, but they don't really change the content specific. Obviously, titled it Somerset Berkley Regional School Resource Officer, but there are a couple of references, especially in the last page, that still read that I'd like to correct and modify that I don't think changed the spirit of the agreement, but that certainly should reflect Somerset Berkley. So once again, be my recommendation. As the board probably is aware, at least, there will be a new school resource officer appointed by the police department, but will still capture the same capacity, and maybe at some future date, it might be something that the board, I think, might be, I think it might be informational. In addition to meeting that individual and maybe talk about his role kind of in the fall and with administration as we look at security and other items, something to consider. Moving forward, but for purposes of tonight, I'd ask that we approve this as we start July 1 with the next process, and certainly have it reflect the regional high school, obviously, and not Somerset School District. Just to give you an idea, the district this year, the region, spent nearly $55,000 on the salary for the school resource officer, $54,000 and change. I was just talking to the regional treasurer today in relation to the two expenses paid out, and so the police department picks up the remaining cost. I'd be happy to speak to any questions. We did not generate this contract. This came from the police department. I simply want to make sure we have it in place, though, moving forward for the upcoming year. And obviously, the chief has asked me to bring this forward to the board. It's something that if there's some concerns, obviously, tonight we can defer to, you know, one of the summer sessions. We still have a couple of months before we start school. But I wanted to bring it to your attention so you at least see the document. If you'd like, I can clean up a couple of those items before, you know, your formal approval is taken, but what I saw, at least the change I was going to make, was simply going to reflect the region, not Somerset Schools.
What is the salary for this contract?
It's actually generated based on what the police department pays. The school department does not dictate the pay of the individual.
It all depends on who the individual
yes,
is and
the officer.
Their stepping schedule.
That's correct. We've budgeted the appropriate amount compared to this year. Chief is aware of that, but we don't control, obviously, there. It's a contractual obligation with his employee as well. But they understand the parameters, and they have to pick up any remaining difference.
But I believe the contract does say that
percentage.
We pay a specific percentage of
that's correct.
The officer's compensation.
That's right. It's in percentage form.
I'm just looking for one here.
So what is the budget for?
Part of that line, Mark, that it's not a separate line for school resource officer. It comes under those supervisors. And we budgeted the same amount, Liz. I'd have to take a look at what that was.
So if it is, because it's by percentage, if it is a higher salary, would be
the potential risk is there. I had that discussion with the chief in relation to that, and he's assured me that based on what he believes is going to be that individual, that's not going to be an issue as it relates from a budget perspective.
Well, I thought I read in the Spectator in the article about Officer Pelletier and his long service in that position that the chief had identified his successor. If that's the case, it's someone with far less experience, so I would assume perhaps a lower cost.
Okay. And I received that information the same way as well, beyond kind of an informal discussion with the chief, but I have not received official notice from the chief in relation to the appointment, but I read that same thing, and it certainly would appear to fall within what we budgeted, if not some savings to the district.
I only have, when I read this, I had two concerns. One, the same idea that we're all talking about, you know, what's the salary going to be, because it is a percentage. Should we, it may not affect this year, but should we put something in this agreement that we will not have anyone at a higher rank? Because let's say we have, let's say Mr. Pelletier, Officer Pelletier was a sergeant or a lieutenant, his salary would be a much higher. Should we put some clause, it may not affect this year, but for the future, that we don't want anyone at a certain rank? Just because it could be a lot more money, because, you know, obviously they're a bump. And the other thing is, does the resource officer also attend middle school?
Yes, he does.
How is Somerset?
That percentage is affected by the police department picking up that cost. The DARE program is picked up by the police department.
By the police, okay.
So that portion of it is
it's based on.
Based on the town side. But once we know the appointed person, I can certainly bring what that salary is and have that percentage. It's easy enough to do, but we certainly can have that information. Moving forward, again, you can see this document is something that's kind of just moved year to year and been in place for some time. I don't think there's anything that says that we can't, you know, look to add some information or detail to it.
I saw it. I read it.
No, so did I.
I'm trying to find it now. It's 42 weeks.
Right.
See that?
73.
Well, Liz, maybe I was thinking, because his salary is based on a full year, we are only paying for 42, so that is a percentage.
What are you going to expect to get out
of it? In my opinion. Judge.
Yeah, it's based on the week's time frame.
Maybe that's how I got it.
According to the contract, it's basically a full-time position for this particular individual working full shift 5 days a week.
And I can certainly obtain who that the new individual is officially from the chief and have that information at a future meeting between July and August if the group is more comfortable. I mean, there's really not a necessity. We're agreeing.
Somerset High School graduate, if George is accurate.
Yes, that was the discussion I had with the chief at the actually recognition assembly in relation to moving forward. So.
So, I'll entertain a motion to approve the school resource officer agreement, which is the same.
Yes. 42
It has not typically included that, but if it's something that the board is requesting, I can ask the chief to provide that information and incorporate into the agreement if that's what.
It doesn't start until September, right?
That's correct.
So, is there any reason why we can't defer it till our next meeting?
No, I don't think so. I can not only maybe make those adjustments where it says Somerset Public Schools, but also get some more detail in relation to the appointment and what the salary is.
So, is the sense of the committee to defer this to our next meeting?
Yes.
Okay. Why? All right. I think that covers the issues that we needed to deal with this evening. We'll go back to the beginning of the agenda. Hopefully we can move through these other items very quickly.
Mr. Chair, yes. I'm going to exit because of work commitment for tomorrow. I thank you for making all the adjustments. I thank the committee for allowing all the adjustments to be made. Thank you.
So the first item under old business is a technology assessment update. Does the guy have the audit?
They were, surveys were submitted or on the website. We received responses from 118 students, 78 parents and guardians, and 58 staff. In talking to the people from Tech Edge, they thought those responses were very good. And they're in the process of kind of culminating that into a report. They're also in the process of reviewing notes from focus groups and interviews, as well as reading final documentation. And they did receive all the documentation that was requested at this point. When the surveys are completely analyzed, they will look at all of that and come back with a report on their findings, which we will have the opportunity to submit to a couple of people to just check the accuracy of the findings, not necessarily agree or disagree, but make sure there's nothing that is inaccurate about it. And that can be done while they develop their recommendations. So I think that we'll probably hear from them. I did speak to Marsha Kaplan earlier this week, and she said that we should have those draft findings by next week.
That seems to be pretty much on schedule. Any questions? Thank you very much. Next item is staffing update.
It appears the update's relatively, should be quick here. 0.8 nurse position was posted, and they'll be conducting interviews to fill that position, the 0.8 nurse position, which is a shared. Took the full-time middle school position, so it's not currently on the website. It's posted, but we had a time frame, and that's why that position was posted. We have winter sports on a lengthy list that you see now as you look to the website under school spring. Winter sports is consistent with that, those annual appointments. We did receive, although it's not official, a relocation for an individual, and I'll be accepting a resignation, so you may see a teacher position open up soon, but it's not official, but that will be a posting between now and our next meeting, and I'll keep the committee updated as it relates to that individual, but certainly allows us enough time to, in high school administration, enough time to fill that position before the start of school. Other than that, we don't have any other postings right now.
Any questions? Staffing. Next item is the Somerset and Berkeley K update. Mr. Machado has left, so we won't have a Somerset update tonight.
Thank you.
You feel compelled?
Well, just to let everybody know, Somerset, a long-standing principal for many, many years for North Elementary, is retired, and we have officially, and please forgive me, but I'm going to turn to Mr. Mazaris on the exact name.
Elaine Saber
has accepted the position for the North Elementary principal here. So very excited. It's a new beginning, but very disappointed too on Mrs. Valenti.
You've also hired a new vice principal at the middle school, correct?
You know what, Mr. Pierce? Yes, we did.
Davis Friedman.
Davis Friedman, he is the vice principal over in the floor of the school system. And he is starting up as of next week, but he's already been in the school working with Mr. Day, with Mrs. Kamara, and getting ready for the school year. So that's where we're at really on the Somerset side.
Mr. Patrick, you have anything to report?
The teachers' union ratified a new 3-year contract, and the school committee approved it. And there's a new floor going into the community school library.
That's right. I know you're a librarian, a wonderful person.
Which is a new floor standard.
Yes, I got a blow report of the work that was involved in moving the furniture and then replacing the floor. And she's very, very happy about it. Next item is school lunch program, which I think we've fully discussed. The next item is health insurance update, and I believe that was intended to be a report of what occurred at the last health insurance meeting, which Mrs. Gagliardi already attended in my absence.
Yeah, and I think I already reported on it. was going through the list of those, I guess they were.
The audit.
The audit, that's right.
The audit verified.
And we cleared the entire audit.
Yes.
So, and there was one issue that they were waiting to get back on, with the birth certificate.
No, we
That was.
Documented everything that was required to be documented.
Okay, great.
So we had four individuals that were affected, and we confirmed with them that they would either be removed or that they had provided the appropriate documentation.
And we have written affidavits from the individuals themselves.
So the next item is the Bristol County Retirement Assessment Update.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, as I explained in the other discussion, we finalized the June 29th payroll today. As a result of that, we have actuals for payroll for FY12. Those actuals will be used for the basis for the assessment to the region for the retirement costs that the town of Somerset incurred for the Bristol County retirement board. Again, the expectation is it's something in the $200,000. The town account had already indicated that looked up a good number to him, and he would have felt more comfortable at year end with the final payroll. And so I would expect to have a final before the committee sometime, probably after next week. I suspect he may not do that next week, the week after perhaps.
Did you say 211 or 220?
211.
And are we paying that directly to Bristol County, or is that still?
That's still to be worked out. I'm under the impression the town was assessed the full amount, has paid the full amount, and therefore the payment will have to go to the town because they already paid the payment, but that's to be determined with the town.
Well, doesn't that raise an issue that if we have to pay it to the town of Somerset rather than directly to the retirement board, we have to have an intermunicipal agreement?
I believe the town's position is that as long as there's agreement on the number, they're comfortable just with the payment. I'm not sure how this board would feel about that. And again, since you don't have a number, I have very few at this point.
And it would be just for this year, because going forward, we'd be able to get a bill
correct. Well,
directly
the
from
basis would be the same. It would be somewhere.
But we'll be able to pay them directly.
Yeah. Although, my understanding is, yeah, is that Bristol County does the assessment in July. There's some sort of deadline that if you make the payment prior to some date in July, you receive some modest 2% reduction in the assessment, 3% or something. So if the town were to take advantage of that early payment option, we'd be kind of in the same boat right now.
All right, I just think we need to get clarification to make sure we're not in a situation where we need some sort of an agreement in place and then we're making the payment beyond the point where we can legitimately make it out of 2012 funds. So we've covered a year-end financial reporting. I guess that's a different item.
Yes, Mr. Chair, that was a new request regarding the reports out to the towns and that. The region has already quite some time ago entered into an agreement with a accounting firm to do audits for the region. It was a very modest expenditure in FY11, and obviously FY12 was your first full year of operation, so there was a suggestion by the audit firm to combine those two periods in doing that first effort. Their findings are what gets reported to the communities when the audit is done. We should have an expectation of that being ready in the fall.
But I think my point on that was that it's a required report to the Board of Selectmen in each community, and it might provide an opportunity for us to provide information above and beyond strictly an auditor's report where we can let both communities know what we've done over the past year and be able to get the report out perhaps to a broader group of people than simply the members of the boards of both communities. So we need to make number 10 is the summer workshop update.
I don't know if the Somerset group, when we know we talked about it formally, I'm not sure if this issue was made. There was some issue with schedules, and Mr. Patrick, I don't know if there's any interest in Berkeley.
They said sure, but they need to have the dates.
Right. I have contacted an individual who is currently a DESE consultant who's done quite a bit of this work, and I'd like you to consider, actually, I'm scheduled to meet with him, maybe a couple of my central office directors, and then maybe my initial discussion was that he would like to establish a time and talk to maybe the two chairs as it relates to how he has done this in the past and give his resume and consideration for the two boards. I've targeted, as I said to him up front, we didn't identify dates. He didn't know dates. I didn't have dates for the boards, but that I was suggesting we try to do something before the start of school. He understood that time frame. So as soon as I get some information, obviously I'd want both boards to feel comfortable with this. The gentleman that I was that I spoke to, his name's Matt George, former superintendent in Brockton some time ago, and has actually been a consultant and worked with several commissioners of education for the department in relation to working with school boards as it relates to roles and responsibilities and superintendents. So, but I indicated to him, obviously, I'd want the boards to feel comfortable with this individual. I had a conversation based on a referral in relation to his work in several other districts, and I can get some information to both Mr. Pierce and Mr. Souza about maybe some dialogue and some consideration. But it is, so it's still in the works, but I haven't identified dates.
Any other discussion on that point?
Will you just iterate a date or two? Because it's almost July, I think.
We can, yeah.
Everyone can't make it because it's on vacation, but.
We'll now that I know that this individual is looking to talk to the chairs and come up with dates, we'll do that in the next week or so. So we'll try to get that information out, because it is something we want to do. I think we should do it, whether the other committee can join us or not. So. All right, the next item on the agenda is the meeting schedule for 2012-13. You have in your packet a list of the proposed meetings, which includes the Somerset K-8 school committee meetings and also the Berkeley school committee meetings. And in looking this over, it appeared to me that there isn't very much conflict with the Berkeley meetings being the same week, at least through early 2013. See these dates, say 12.
Get the 12.
13. There is, in, and it doesn't appear to be a conflict in February. In March, the meeting would be the same week. And in April, it would not be. And in May, it would be. So, and in June, it would be. Is that a problem for you, Mr. Patrick?
I can make it.
Okay. Well, some of these meetings, as they during that time frame when we're working on budget, may be adjusted anyway. So I'd suggest we approve this this schedule. I believe we're required to establish a schedule of meetings at the beginning of the year, but it is subject to change.
We just also designate which ones are being burned. I thought we were going to do that, but it doesn't look like this. So we're going to do every fourth meeting.
Yeah, that's what I thought too, which is fine.
It's not only September 27th.
It would be September 27th, December 13th, March 14th, and May 23rd.
All right. Without addition, I have a motion to approve the schedule with designating every fourth meeting in Berkeley. As was just enumerated.
So moved.
Is there a second? Motion made by Mr. Gagliotti and seconded by Mr. Kelly. Any further discussion?
This is too many meetings.
You know what? I was just thinking, we have joint meetings with the Somerset City and Somerset Region. Maybe those meetings that we're scheduling to be in Berkeley, we could align with the Berkeley school committee meetings and have a joint meeting with them. But We can approve this, and you can maybe talk to your group about it and see.
Certainly, if we have an issue that we need to discuss, we'd be happy to have a joint meeting with them.
Second.
So a motion made by Mrs. Gagliotti and seconded by Mrs. White. Any further discussion? All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no.
Nay.
All right, the chair votes aye, 6-1. And I believe under building committee update, we can just briefly indicate that the elevated bids were received. They were just slightly higher than the allowance of $300,000. But the bid is still significantly under budget, and that number was included in the contract that we've already approved. Mr. Gagliotti or Mr. Souza, could you just a very brief update on the groundbreaking schedule for tomorrow?
We start at 1 o'clock with the ceremony. It will last about 1 hour. We have a number of people speaking, but more importantly, we have student participation throughout the program. At this point, we have nearly 150 people who have responded. And then following the program, we will have a reception in the art gallery, a taste of the town's reception. So, looking forward to the event. Did I miss anything?
I think the last time when we talked, we didn't know if the commissioner was going to be present. The commissioner is going to be. We found out too, the former director of the MSBA,
Kevin
Craven, will be here as well. It's turning out to be, I think, a very, very nice event. And also, I would like to thank Curtis and Mr. Kenny for doing a lot of hard work in cleaning up the front and mulching, the front to get ready, for all the visitors.
Looks great. The mulch was donated by Fisher Construction, so throughout the whole process, we got a series of donations. It's been a lot of effort on the part of the whole community to put it together, so it's worked out very well.
Well, I think that the communications subcommittee of the building committee has worked very, very hard on this, including some members of the high school administration. But I think we owe a debt of gratitude to our committee members, Mrs. Gagliotti and Mr. Souza, who are both on the communications committee and have worked extremely hard on this. I know that they've been running around for the last 2 weeks finalizing this and really have devoted a lot of time and effort to it. So thank you very much. The next item is Somerset Berkley Regional High School Students of the Month for May and June. And I will read those. The Art Department, Abigail Lane, grade 9. This is for the month of May. The Business Department, Zachary Murphy, grade 11. English Department, Eden Gius, grade 9. Oh, I got that.
Nice.
Right? Engineering Technology Department, Edward Pacheco Jr., grade 12. Mathematics Department, Nicholas Costa, grade 11. Music Department, Lucas Bollier, grade 10. Science Department, Daniel White, grade 11. Social Studies Department, Lauren Sylvia, grade 12. Wellness Department, Jennifer Minton, grade 11. And World Languages Department, Regan Warren, grade 9. For the month of June, the Business Department, Benjamin Ferreira, grade 11. English Department, Sarah Damaris, grade 11. English Tech Department.
Engineering Tech Department.
Ayla Murr, grade 9. Mathematics Department, Jason Macaro, grade 11. Science Department, Abigail Lane, grade 9. Social Studies Department, Jessica Robertson, grade 11. Wellness Department, Jennifer Gadu, grade 11. and World Languages Department, Constance Pereira, grade 10. Congratulations to all of them. One more item, professional development activities for April and May.
Thank you, Mr. Pierce. Thank you. At this point, I'll provide an overview of key professional development during April and May. You know, as part of the district's ongoing training on nonviolent crisis intervention, three of our high school staff attended crisis prevention intervention training. This is offered through South Coast Educational Collaborative. And this is part of the cohort of staff who are designated to serve as school-wide resources for administering physical restraints. That training will continue into the next school year, and that'll be part of our school-wide resources for nonviolent crisis intervention. As you know, a major focus at the regional high school and certainly across the districts in English language arts and mathematics has been the shift to the revised state curriculum frameworks. And of course, within those frameworks, the Common Core standards are embedded. Now, we've made several revisions initially to the high school English language arts curriculum. On April 24th, Dr. Doucette facilitated a session with all of the grade 10 ELA teachers in facilitating the shift to the revised framework. So we've made initial revisions in grades 9 to 12. So really in mathematics and English language arts, we've really fast-tracked those revisions because the department has an ambitious timeline in terms of near full implementation for 2012-13 and full implementation for 2013-14. Now, as you know, Massachusetts has adopted a new teacher evaluation framework, and four of our administrators from the high school attended a session offered by the Massachusetts Secondary School Administrators Association. This was on April 25th, and this is a session focusing on the implementation of the new teacher evaluation regulations. This training will also continue into the summer, focusing on administrative training, and then we'll use a trainer of the training model to work with teachers in implementing this new framework. This has been an initiative supported by the Race to the Top initiative here in Somerset. As part of the ongoing Race to the Top initiative, we've had four vertical articulation meetings. This is focused on the pre-advanced math placement. One of the sessions, we've actually had four sessions, and we had the meetings that took place on April 30th and May 21st. That included teachers from Berkley Middle School, Somerset Middle School, and Somerset Berkley Regional. Those are math teachers focusing on articulation of math curriculum grades 6 to 10. And that work will continue into the second year as well. So we had four vertical articulation meetings. And really the purpose of that is to see how our curriculum is articulated and coordinated, not only from Berkeley Middle and Somerset Middle as it segues to the high school. And in addition, two of our high school teachers attended pre-AP math training this week. That was year one. And three additional high school teachers will be trained in late August. That's year two. So the pre-AP math training is a, essentially it's a three-year initiative to Race to the Top. So we've been very pleased with the outcome of that work. And as I mentioned before, you know, a major focus at the high school certainly has been the shift to the English language arts and math frameworks. And on May 17th and May 24th, grades 9 and 10 continued work on alignment with math curriculum. Those sessions focused on the new Model Math 3 course and the Algebra 1 courses. So I think in terms of grade 9 to 10, the initial shift, I think it's been successful in terms of being prepared with the new frameworks for next year.
Thank you very much. Any questions? Thank you, Dr. Smith. That concludes our agenda. I'll be happy to entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Motion made by Mrs. Suzerain, seconded by Mrs. Gagliotti. Any discussion?